Where's your boots? Huh? Hey, Asher. Hey, Layton. Hey, Nathan. Hey, Luke. How you doing? We've already been talking. We've already been chatting. We was waiting on the slow pokes, weren't we? Hey, good morning. Thank you for coming up here and be with me for just a second. Some of you can't do this, so you can look. There he is. Let me see your mask. Okay. Cool. I like that. Not everybody can do this, but not everybody can do this, and I'm not asking you to do this. I just want you to look at me, okay? You ready? I'm going to do something. I'm going to do something. I'm going to do something nasty. Everybody look at me. Well, I got everybody's attention then, didn't I? I'm going to do something nasty. You ready? Here it goes. We're not supposed to stick our tongue out, are we? My mama used to tell me that I shouldn't stick my tongue out because usually I was facing her when I was doing it. And then I was running away from her when I was doing it. But my mom always tell me, you're not supposed to stick your tongue out because it's nasty. It's disrespect. We just shouldn't do that. So being we shouldn't stick our tongue out, and God has given each and every one of us a tongue, right? Do all y'all have tongues this morning?
Yeah.
Okay, just checking. What do we use our tongue for?
Licking ice cream.
Licking ice cream.
Amen.
Well, we use it for eating. We use it for tasting. Anything else? What? There it is. We use it for talking. It'd be very difficult for me to talk this morning if I did not have a tongue, right? Right? So we have to have our tongue has a purpose. And the Bible is very clear of how we should be using our tongue. And it's not to be sticking it out at people, right? But it is to be used in the good way of how we use our words. Everybody look at me. Everybody look at me. We're to use our tongues to say kind words, to say good words. And the Bible says we're to use our tongue to build people up. In other words, we're to say kind things. We're to say kind things to them. We're not to say hateful and mean things to our friends. Well, to anybody. We're not to use our tongue for that. That's not why God gave it to us. How many of you have ever seen a beehive? How many of you have ever seen honeycomb? Don't a bee make honey? Is it the bee?
Yeah.
You ever seen a honeycomb? Do you like honey?
I've seen it on TV.
Saw it on TV? Do y'all like honey?
Yeah.
Honey is good. And that's what the Bible tells us is how our words are to be. And here it is. The Bible says pleasant words are like a honeycomb, sweetness to the soul and health to the bones. So listen to me. If you're listening, say, I am. Our words are not only supposed to be used to build other people up, to say kind things, but the Bible tells me that when I use kind words, it gives me also good health. So always use kind words. Make your words drip with honey, just like a honeycomb does. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for these kids. And God, I ask for your favor and your blessings upon them. God, will you do me a favor this morning? Will you help us to use kind words? Will you help us to use nice words and good words to everybody that we talk to help build them up? And God, will you help our words be like honeycomb, be sweetness to our soul and health to our bones. Lord, we love you and we thank you. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you'll go to Miss Rhonda, she's got something for you. Thank you. Will y'all give God a hand for our kids? As we transition, would you please take out a copy of God's Word that you brought from home and turn with me once again to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. And we are continuing this morning our study and our series called Our Attitude About the Beatitudes. Our Attitude About the Beatitudes. Now I'm going to give you just a moment to find your place there in Matthew chapter 5. And we'll be looking at only verse 9 this morning. And here in just a few moments, I want to share with you about, take this passage of Scripture and share with you about this passage and the place of this passage in my life personally. And then I want to share with you the placement of this passage in the Bible, of where and of where Jesus Christ has said this. And then I want to challenge you and I want to encourage you this morning about the position and the placement of this passage of Scripture in your own life. If you're listening, say, I am. I do not think that it is by chance, that it is by fate, that it is by happenstance. Now, I'm not this good. And it's not because some weeks ago or months ago I decided that we needed to hear a sermon and I needed to preach a sermon on the Beatitudes. The attitudes that are to be in our life as a disciple of Jesus Christ, as a follower, as a Christian. But I think it's kind of amazing that this morning, of all mornings, we find ourselves at the seventh Beatitudes from the words and the mouth of Jesus Christ as He was sitting on the side of that mountain. And I know a lot of you that have been here with me during this series, you may be tired of hearing it, but I can guarantee you, if somebody ever asks you where was Jesus when He was preaching the Beatitudes, you can tell him, you can tell them. But Jesus is standing on sitting on the side of the mountain. Today it's called the Mount of Beatitudes, right there by the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus is saying, if you'll allow me for just a second, give me a little bit of leniency here. Jesus is going through these Beatitudes and pouring into His disciples' life, those followers, those that I call, that have been called. And not only are the called there, but I think there's a congregation there, and they're easing up, and they're there, and they're listening. I think the Pharisees are there, and they're listening to these words of Jesus. And at this particular place and time, we find ourselves at blessed are the peacemakers. Now, sir and ma'am, this is, as you count, this is the seventh beatitude from the words of Jesus Christ. And I didn't bog myself down there, but I got to thinking, how unique is it that this beatitude is number seven? Because when you study, and as you all know, as you study and you look at in Hebrew the number of seven, it is the number of that represents that of completeness. And here we have Jesus Christ, the Messiah, saying, blessed are the peacemakers. Are y'all okay? That if one man needed to say this, and if one man represented this text in its truest sense, it is the one that was standing there or sitting there on the side of the mountain that was complete as the Son of God and, yes, also the Son of Man. But there's another placement about this verse. Last week, we looked at when Jesus said, blessed are the pure in heart. Sir, man, we have to have a pure heart if we're going to love God. We have to be pure in heart if we're going to serve God. And guess what? We have to understand that we need to be pure in heart before we can be a peacemaker of God and a peacemaker for God. You can't get one before the other. And Jesus Christ knew that. And I think it's just marvelous and magnificent. It is placed exactly where it needs to be from Jesus. I don't believe I've ever told, except the 9 o'clock service, I will tell you this morning that blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Was the very first passage of Scripture that I submitted to memory. I do not know what it is about this verse. I was telling the congregation this morning, at a very young age, for some reason, somehow, some way, I don't know where it came from, I don't know where it is today, but I had this charm, and this charm, it went on a necklace, and it, I mean, Mr. T would have wore this charm. I mean, it was honking. And it was an eagle, and on the eagle's wings, or around the edges of the wings of the eagle, It had these words inscribed on that metal. It was silver. It was dingy. It was dirty. But you could still make it out that it was an eagle and it was Scripture. And I don't know why, but on the, I don't know why I had it, but on those wings was etched the words, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." Matthew 5, 9. And actually, I kept that charm for a long, long, very long time. I would really love to know where it is today. Mr. Brian's going to help us out with something here in just a second. And when I was in Israel, and we went, one of the very first locations that we went to, not the first, but one of the first, was we went to the Mount of Beatitudes. And this picture here that you're getting ready to see in just a few seconds is as you walk into, I call it a garden, but as you walk into the site there of the Mount of Beatitudes, one of the first places you come to is the synagogue that is there. Is that not pretty or what? Just a beautiful structure, beautiful garden. It looked like everything was just manicured and landscaped beautifully. And I don't believe I walked in that synagogue that day. There was some time of preaching. There was some time of praise. And then we had a little bit of alone time, so to speak. And we got alone around the Mount of Beatitudes, or on the Mountain of Beatitudes there at the Sea of Galilee. And as I was walking around, I noticed that every now and again there was a beveled granite monument there. And as I started paying attention, I thought, well, I know that. That's the Beatitudes. And they were scattered and they were sprinkled, so to speak, throughout. And I was looking for "Blessed are the peacemakers." And I took a picture of that monument sitting there. And I found myself just standing there, just concentrating and just staring at that reminder. And that was the only picture or the only monument that I took a picture of while I was standing there, because of what that verse, and I can't explain it, don't have to, don't even know why I'm telling you. But that verse had an impact on my life at such an early age. Sir, ma'am, I'm going to go ahead and tell you this. The first thing I want to tell you is that I love you. And I've never lied to you, and I'm not going to start now. But everything from this point on that I'm getting ready to say, I want you to understand that it is not political. But I will tell you that if there's ever been a time in the history of my life that we need to submit this passage of Scripture to our heart, it is now. We need to be peacemakers. We need to be peacemakers in these United States of America. It is now like never before. Are y'all hearing me? Are y'all okay? I got to thinking about something. You know, we say when we stand and we look at that at the flag, as we look at the nickname Old Glory, and we put our hand over our heart and we say the Pledge of Allegiance. What, there's a phrase in there, and I couldn't get off that phrase preparing this text. And in that Pledge of Allegiance, we say a phrase that goes like this: "One nation under God." Y'all okay? Don't we say that when we do that? Which got me to thinking, are we one nation under God? Let me say this parenthetically. I truly believe, let me get so the people in the back can hear me. I truly believe that God is still on the throne. And I also truly believe that God has, God is, and God will still continue to bless these United States of America. Well, Jason, you're getting political. No, I'm getting biblical. Listen to me. If we are what we say we are as one nation under God, sir and ma'am, can I ask you a question? Then why aren't we acting like it? Why aren't we acting like it? Why aren't we looking like it? I'll tell you why. And when I say, well, I tell you why, talking about you, talking about me, I'm not talking about you and I'm not talking about me. I'm talking about the New Testament church. I'm talking about those that carry the name of a Christian this day and time in the United States of America. If there's ever been a time we need to be peacemakers, sir and ma'am, it is now. And Jesus said these words in Matthew 5:9. I've said them 3 or 4 times now. Well, would you look in your Bible real quick, please? In the Bible, Matthew 5:9, Jesus says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God." Now, we got to understand, and I have prefaced each one of these Beatitudes with something that is going on here. And for us to understand what is being said then, so we can understand what is being said to us today, we need to understand the background of this text. And I want you to understand something. When Jesus said these Beatitudes, when the disciples were hearing these words for the first time, these were radical statements from Jesus. And I've told you about the tone and the text of each of the how each one was radical. And I'm not going to stop now. We got to understand that what was going on that day and time. For Jesus to say this when He said, stay with me now, "Blessed are the peacemakers." The reason Jesus is talking about this, the reason Jesus is saying that, is because of what was going on with the government. Because when you look at Judeans and when you look at Galileans, they were not in favor of the Roman government. If a Galilean or if a Judean wanted to do anything, it was to fight the Romans. They would rather fight a Roman than eat when they were hungry. That's how bad the government was despised then and there and at that time. So you've got this hate that is between, I'll say, the people and the government. And then you've got this man named Jesus saying, "Blessed are you." Want to be happy? You want to be blessed? Then be a peacemaker. Hold up, Jesus. Oh, man, you don't understand the government. Oh, but he did. In other words, let me say it like this. In other words, Jesus was saying, watch this now. This is going to bless you. I'm probably not going to get a response, but it's going to bless you. Jesus is saying, if you're a disciple of mine, then this is what a disciple looks like. This is what it looks like to be a follower of mine. It's to be a peacemaker. See, the Judeans and the Galileans, they knew. Now watch this. I'm going to give you this a little bit of history nugget, and then I'm going to start preaching. You got to understand that when the Judeans and the Galileans, they knew that God was going to establish His kingdom. But here's what they thought. They knew the kingdom was going to be established for the people. But they thought it was going to be established by there being a war. And they were going to be victorious of the war because God was on their side. God was going to show them favor. They didn't understand it was going to come through Jesus Christ. Of how the kingdom, they didn't get that at this point in time. And when you think about that, and when you understand that, when your mind is, and I've tried to do the best of my ability so you can understand what is going on in the minds of the disciples, so we can understand what goes on in our mind, so the Scripture can have an impact in our life today, because what Jesus said didn't just apply on the side of that mountain, it applies to what's going on in Ashe, North Carolina today. Here at Soldier Bay Baptist Church and all the lives that are represented in this sanctuary this morning. And so Jesus says this statement of blessed are the peacemakers. And everything there, once again, is radical because what Jesus is doing is, think about this, it's not going to be from war. You're not going to become victorious because of a war. But you're going to become victorious as a Christian. You're going to become victorious in the kingdom of God because Jesus asserts and assigns that the kingdom is going to be for the meek. The kingdom is going to be for the merciful. The kingdom is going to be for the persecuted. And the kingdom is going to be for the peacemakers. And He drills down even more. As you keep reading the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5-7, you see things and you hear things of Jesus going back and supporting, are y'all okay? Of supporting the text because He starts explaining a little bit more. He says, you've heard of an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. You've heard that you need to turn that other cheek. My daddy always told me when it come to fighting, he said, as a Christian, they get the first two licks. You'll get that on the way home. We're to turn the other cheek. And he says, if you go the 1 mile, you need to go the 2 mile for other. And Jesus starts saying this, and this tone of the text starts changing of their thinking and what is going on there. And Jesus says, but I tell you, do not resist evil people. Jesus says, but I tell you, love. Here's a good word. Jesus says, love your enemies. There's some enemies we want God to bless them with a brick. Jesus says, no. You love your, watch this now. Jesus says, love your enemies and pray for those that persecute you. Let me tell you, I'm a metal. Anybody mad at anybody this morning? You got anybody you're mad at this morning? Can I help you real quick? Let me help you out real fast. Are you mad at anybody right now? Are you? Don't call any names. Are you mad? You know how to change it? Pray for them. You can't stay mad at anybody you're praying for. Rhonda. You can't stay mad at it. Rhonda's my wife, by the way. She's sitting right here. You can't stay mad at anybody you're praying for. Jesus said, love them. Yeah. And this is what it's going to look like. Can I tell you real quick? Let me tell you real quick. Let me tell you what I've come up with this past week in preparing for this. Let me tell you, the problem is not the pandemic. The problem is not politics. The problem is not protest. That is not the problem. It is a problem. It is not the problem. The problem is not the pandemic of the world. The problem is not the protest of the world. The problem is not the politics of the world. Let me tell you where the problem comes from. The problem comes from, sir and ma'am, you need to be listening to this as a child of God. The problem comes from who John calls the prince of the world. And the prince of the world is the devil himself. That's our adversary. That's the one that's out to get us and is against us. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you find yourself, I don't know why I'm saying this, but maybe somebody needs to hear it. If you find yourself in a mode of praise and worship to God, the devil's going to go ahead and start working overtime in your life, because the sole responsible of the devil is to get the praise and the worship off of God. You want a battle? You want a battle? The devil's up for the battle. And all he wants to do is divert your attention. That's why I talk about, that's why I pray about. Don't be distracted of everything that's going on, but be dedicated to God Almighty. Look for Him. Somebody say amen. It'll just help me. If you don't, I'm going to quit preaching. I'm just kidding. I'm going to preach harder. It's the prince. John called Him the prince of the world. You know what Isaiah called Him? You know what Isaiah called Jesus? The prince of, say it with me, peace. That's our problem this morning. Ephesians 6:12, everybody knows it, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. You want me to tell you what it's called? It's called spiritual warfare. Sir, man, we are in a battle. You may say, what does this have to do with peacemaking? Hang on. We're in a spiritual battle. Let me tell you where spiritual warfare will lead us if our eyes are not on Christ, if our eyes are not on concentrating, if our heart is not right, if we're disconnected from God, if we're not close to God. Please find yourself in your own personal praise and prayer time. Do not get disconnected from God, because when you get disconnected from God, you'll get distractions from the devil. That's a good word that somebody needs to tweet right now. But when spiritual warfare happens, I'm going to tell you what it leads to. It leads to war, worry, wonder, and destruction and division. And if you're not careful, if that's the only thing you're concentrating on, apart from Jesus Christ, not placing your faith in Him, not only is it going to divide, not only is it going to cause destruction, it's going to cause hate, and you're going to end up in hell. And we've got to protect ourselves. Well, Jason, how do I protect myself? You need to look in the Bible. You need to know the Bible. You need to get close to God. And you need to put on the armor of God. Ephesians 6:11 says, put it on that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. What's that got to do with peacemaking? Hang on. I'm not bragging. I need to hurry, because some of y'all want to go get the white meat. Listen to me. Let me tell you what I do. Every morning, I try, every morning, unless something happens, either the phone rings or whatever, I try every morning before I wake up, let me tell you what I do, when my eyes open, before I roll, before I get up, I look at the heavens, and I say, God, this day, put on me the helmet of salvation. God, put on me the breastplate of righteousness. God this morning put on me, shod my feet with the gospel. God put on me the belt of truth. God today, in my dominant hand, in my right hand, that one I can swing with all my strength, God put in my hand the sword of the Spirit. Sir, ma'am, it's not going to be at that point in time that you'll be able to withstand the schemes of the devil. We've got to suit ourselves. We've got to place ourselves in the armor of God. Because if we do not, we will not be doing what Jesus said. And Jesus says we are to be peacemakers. And the only way we're going to be able to make peace is if we have on the armor of God. Does any of this make sense? Is it clear as mud? Are you okay in the house of God this morning? We need to protect ourselves. Because if we don't do it, there's going to be conflict. And then Jesus knew that. That's why Jesus gives us an exposition and then He gives us an expectation. He said, blessed. You want to be happy? That's what blessed means, but it's a lot deeper than that. You want to be happy? You want to be blessed? Be a peacemaker. We have the exposition. And then He gives us the expectation. Well, Jason, I don't know about all that. Look up here just a second. I know I'm not pretty, but just look up here just a second. I can't do that. Jason, think you just don't know all that I'm going through. You don't know what I have on me this morning. You don't know what I have on me this week with my family, with my work, my mama's in the hospital, this is happening. There's a surgery, there's a diagnosis, there's a disease, there's a death, there's COVID, there's cancer. You don't understand, Jason. I can't give peace because I do not have peace in my life. Let me say something parenthetically. Please understand this. Sir, ma'am, you cannot give away something you do not have. If you come up to me right now and ask me for $5, I could give it to you. If you come up to me right now and ask me for $20, I'd have to ask Rhonda, but I think I can give it to you. I don't have any money on me. But I feel sure I could probably give you $20. But if you come up to me right now, this very second, and ask me for $100, I couldn't give it to you because I don't have it. See, we got to understand something. We are not the source of the strength of our peace. The source of our peace is Jesus Christ. That's why it's important not to get disconnected from God. We can only give away what we have, and we can only get it from God. That's why we have to be close to God. We have to be a conduit, not a container. See, container stuff, you keep things in. You don't take it out. You leave it there for storage. So either we're this morning, we find ourselves being a container of peace or a container of chaos. When Jesus makes it very clear, He commands us, He charges us this morning with the discipline of being a peacemaker, of being a conduit and giving it out and letting it go. And you say, Jason, I can't do that. You're right, you can't apart from God's help. Jesus said in Matthew 28:18, He says, all, this will make a Methodist shout. Jesus said in Matthew 28:18, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. And He's our source. We should find ourselves living in a manner and a means and a way of making peace with people. But Jason, you don't know what they said. You don't know what they done. They talked junk about me. They said something about my youngin'. Said something about my grand youngin'. Pastor Charlie, I told 9 o'clock years ago, we used to have the evangelist, and I know you're probably not going to remember him. I'm just joking, but his name was Steve Gunner. And Steve stood right here, and he made this statement. And I was sitting right up there where Ashley Williams is sitting right now. I'll never forget as long as I live. I was sitting there, he was standing here, and he made this statement. He says, I thought when I became a pastor, everybody would like me. It's not true, is it, Pastor Charlie? It's not true, is it, Pastor Zach? It's not true. People have told me to my face they don't like me. But watch this. Don't feel sorry for me. Don't do that. You're going to miss the point. And some of you are probably thinking, well, I kind of know why people don't like you. Tony, get out. I'm just kidding. Let me tell you something. Jesus said it ain't about who likes you or not. No matter what, you're to be a peacemaker. He didn't say be a peacemaker to those that like you. He said be a peacemaker. To be a peacemaker. See, what happens a lot of times, and I know I'm out of time, but listen to me. Don't shut your brain off, pretty please. Because I hadn't even got to the sermon. I'm just kidding. Let me tell you what we're after. You pay attention to the news and pay attention to what's happening. And what you're going to find is you're going to find people are more interested in the retaliation than they are the restoration. And Jesus said it's not about the retaliation. He calls us to be a peacemaker, that of restoration. Of restoration. In all of our relationships. Psalm 34:14. Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Paul said, do all in Romans 12:18. He says, do all that you can to live in peace with everybody. And if anybody knew anything about different backgrounds of people of culture and country, it was the Apostle Paul. The Jews, the Gentiles, the Democrats, the Republicans, the whites, the blacks, the Hispanics. I don't care what it is. The Bible says do all that you can to live in peace with everyone. That's what the Bible says. And the reason we're no longer, it seems like, a nation under God is for the simple fact we have gotten away from the Bible. Go ahead and take the wrath on. Go ahead. I'm not mad. I'm passionate. Go ahead. Do me a favor. Go ahead and take the wrath on. You do the wrath that you think needs to be done. Go ahead and see what happens. Let me tell you something. Don't you ever take the wrath of God in your role. Because the moment you take up that wrath and you think you need to give it out and you need to disperse it, the moment we take on the wrath of God is the moment that God will leave you. He'll say, go ahead. Handle it. See what happens. Moses said in Deuteronomy, he said, we must give place to the wrath. In other words, let God have it. And Jesus sought peace. And if we seek Jesus, Jesus sought peace. And if we seek Jesus, we get the second part of the Beatitude when Jesus says, for they shall be called the sons of God or the children of God. I don't know if Brother Gary's downstairs or not still, but he was earlier and he's got a brand. I don't know how old James Dean is now. How much? 8 months. But a while ago I was walking up through the thing down there, hallway, and somebody was looking at James Dean. And they said, Gary, he looks just like you. Poor child. I'm kidding. Gary, I'm kidding. Can I ask you a question? Do you look like your mama or your daddy? What have you been told your whole life? Who do you look like? That's not the question this morning. The question this morning is, do we look like a child of God this morning? Can I ask you a question? And I've got a couple of them. If you're listening, say, I am. This past week, have we looked like that we belong to God? Have we looked like our Heavenly Father in all the aspects of our life? This week, have you sought peace at home? Have you sought peace at your job or your work? With your customers? With your patients? Have you sought peace in public? Have you sought peace with the public? This morning, Wednesday morning when I was sitting there in the parking lot hospital. The hospital parking lot. My windows were cracked and this person pulled up beside me and I'd been there 2 or 3 hours just waiting for a verdict on Mama. And this man got out of his vehicle. I was telling Rhonda about it. And I heard the awfulest language that I could ever possibly hear coming out of his mouth. And I'm just grateful that my daughter was not in my vehicle. And it got so bad, I leaned up, because stuff like that I try to ignore. Because let me say something about cussing. Can I say this real quick? Let me tell you something about cussing. It's a public display of ignorance. Anyway, he started letting her rip. And I leaned up and looked to see who it was. First of all, I was seeing if I could take him. I'm kidding. And I looked up, and he was a little old man. And he was tearing his truck apart. And I put together, obviously I can't tell you what he was saying. But he was looking for his mask. And I had it about here. And right behind my seat is a box of masks. And I reached behind me and I got a mask and I got out my truck. And by this time he was on the other side. And I walked around the truck and I went up to him. I said, "Do you need one of these?" He said, "No, I found one." I said, "Well, thank the Lord." He said, "I'm so sorry." I didn't say a word. I said, "I hope you have a better day." And I said it lovingly. And I turned around. He said, "I was kind of upset." I know. He said, "I'm sorry." It's okay. And I went back in my truck, and about an additional 2 hours later, he came out, and he was just a grinning, and it looked like about 500 feet. I'm just watching, and he started waving and smiling at me and just waving. Musicians, will you come? Thank you for your patience. I'm passionate about this message, and I'm not going to apologize. But I want to share something with you real quick. In the 4th century, there was an old monk by the name of Telemachus. And Telemachus was working at the monastery. And he said he heard clear from God, "You need to go to Rome." And Telemachus packed everything he had in a little sack and he made his way to Rome. And when he got to Rome, it was chaos. There were people in the street. They were running around. Everybody was acting crazy. And they were pushing. And Telemachus said, "What in the world is going on?" They said, "Haven't you heard? Today's the day of the circus. Today's the day of the gladiator fights. And everybody's making their way to the Colosseum." And Telemachus thought, he said, 400 years after Christ has lived and died, people are still killing people for fun. And he made his way into the Colosseum. And he sat there and he watched the gladiator after gladiator after gladiator till he felt like he had to do something. And he jumped over the wall and he went and he stood right in the middle of two big gladiators. until Malchus looked up and he says, "In the name of Christ, forbear." And one of the gladiators just smacked him just as hard as he could, and he fell on his back. And Telemachus said, "In the name of Christ, forbear." And he got back up, and he stood in the middle of those gladiators. And the crowd started shouting and chanting, "Run through him! Run through him!" And the other gladiator took his sword out and just ran it through Telemachus. And he fell on the ground. And in his dying breath, with the dirt turning crimson, he said, "In the name of Christ, forbear." The whole Colosseum went quiet. And one man stood up and he walked out the Colosseum. And about that time, another man stood up and he walked out the Colosseum. And over a few minutes, the history books tells us, in just a few minutes, 80,000 people in that Colosseum walked out, never said a word, and went out the Colosseum. And it was that day, and it was that time, that you'll find in the history books was the last gladiator contest in the 4th century of Rome. Sir, ma'am, if there's ever a time, in the name of Christ, forbear. It's now. Heavenly Father, as we pause, we reflect, Lord. And God, I'm just asking you right now, Lord, to do only what you can do, Lord. God, you help us. Change us, convict us. God, I pray for your breath. I pray for you to move this morning in this congregation. That right now you'll just create a revival. You'll create a renewal, Lord, in our life of being a peacemaker. For we are to be the children of God. God, this morning will you help us? It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Sir, ma'am, will you stand? I asked you a question at the beginning. And I'm going to close with another one. Are we acting this morning like one nation under God? Maybe God has spoke to you. I'm going to hush in just a second. I promise you. Are we acting like a one nation under God right now? Will you have a talk with God right now, please? And I tell you what my prayer is. My prayer is that this day, under those that can hear my voice and see my heart, that not only will we go back to being one nation under God, but we'll look like a nation that belongs to God as His children. Father God, move now in the only way that you can. Amen. Will you come this morning? Church, if there's ever a time we need to be at the altar praying for peace, it is now. Won't you come this morning? Will you come this morning? Has God spoke to you? This ain't about guilt. This is about God.